at the end we will have the discussion.
Okay,
sir. Good morning, one and all present here. It is our pleasure to have Mr. Manjunath, our student and 2012 passed out batch, and now he is working for Dell company and as a data scientist. And actually, he only voluntarily called me and asked, "Ma'am, shall I give one session for our students?" So I should thank Manjunath in this time for your willingness and giving this webinar. And today he is going to talk about the exploring the data-driven world and understanding the buzzwords like AI, ML, and data science. So he will introduce himself and what is his journey from 2012 to till now. And Manjunath, over to you.
Yep. Thanks a lot, madam. Thanks everyone for joining this session. I hope it would be a worthy 1 hour for next 60 minutes or so. A couple of things. As I speak, if there are any questions, don't hesitate to ask it as and when, if it is required. Right? We don't have to keep it to the end. We can have this as a dialogue. I prefer having a dialogue. If there are some things which are in doubt, let's have that sorted, right? Even before I begin to share this fascinating stuff about the world of machine learning, data science, AI, and other things, it's my job that I introduce myself to you. I will start with two stories, basically, that are part of my engineering days. I was on the third batch of RRCE 2008, that is when I joined, and 2012 is when I finished my engineering. I was good. I was good with my studies. I was above average. In fact, in my first 3 years of engineering, I was in almost like top 10 with respect to the scoring. Then in the last year, I was there in top one or two, right? I was one of the toppers. The fact that I finished my engineering in the year 2012 and got the results somewhere around June 2012. And then there was this alumnus meet, which was called in the year 2013, basically to say that that was a convocation kind of function where RRCE wanted to call their toppers and felicitate them and those kind of things. The fact that I did not have that job, even when it was 2013, almost a year after I passed my engineering, I was very embarrassed and I could not go there. It was not only me, there were many other topper colleagues of mine, my friend Manish and all. So we did not go there, and I'm sure that certificate and medal is sitting somewhere in the EC department even today, which I not got it, or just because I did not visit the RRCE college until today. So one thing that I want to tell you, I know that this is a time of pandemic where there are a lot of job cuts. It is very difficult for the freshers to get in, or the job market is not doing so great. So one thing I wanted to tell you from my experience of life is that don't panic. Your current situation does not tell you where you are going to end up, right? So your future is not dependent on where you are today. That is one story that I wanted to tell you. Second thing I wanted to tell you is, see, I did my schooling, everything in this regional language, Kannada medium. So until third year engineering, I did not know how to speak well in English, okay? That was one of my issues. So even though I had very good scores, every time I would meet my professors and lecturers, whether it is Vijaya Madam, Bhuvaneshwari Madam, or it is Santosh Sir, Vani Madam, everybody, right? They would always tell me, if you don't improve your communication, you would never get into a IT world kind of thing. So one thing that happened to me is, specifically because this was already a final year in engineering 2012 and I wanted to get into the world of job, I knew that I had to push myself. So one good thing happened to me is Vani Madam was teaching real-time systems to me. That was in seventh semester, which is a part of our syllabus during that period. I'm not certain if it is for now, So what she did is she allowed me to give those seminars on stage. So she would allocate some topics to me beforehand, one day prior, and she would say, okay, go ahead and present this as a seminar. So I would go ahead, prepare that complete topic. I would not even look at the book. I would just go near the board, and for 1 hour entirely, I would just give the lectures, right? That's how I built my confidence. So without these professors and lecturers, I would not have been half a man I am today. So I must say that I'm very indebted to all my lecturers and professors. I know I don't even remember a single line of electronics and communication today because I don't use it in my official day-to-day thing. But they have given me many things. They have built my character. They have built my guts. They have helped me build, become a man I have become today. So I'm really thankful to all my professors and lecturers, specifically Kumar sir as well, who's not there with RRC now. So I'm really thankful for this opportunity that you presented to me, that I'm here presenting and talking to you about the world of data science. So this is about me as I was when in my student life, right? So post that, I've seen multiple companies. I've worked in many, many big companies with very good responsibilities and roles. I've been part of Thomson Reuters, which is an international media company. Then I've been part of EY, which is called one of the big four companies, where I was a senior data scientist. I've been part of CGI, which is one of the biggest service management firm in the world. And then I'm currently working as a lead data scientist with Dell, where I lead the enterprise level solutions for tax systems, right? So Dell is a very big company with its global foot across all the countries in the world. And then they need to pay taxes as well. So it becomes very important that we comply with all the governments across the world. So I build, along with my team, the data solutions with respect to AI and ML solutions. And I make sure that Dell is as compliant as possible when it comes to the paying of taxes and managing the taxes, everything. So that is all about me. I'll pause here. If you have any questions, I'll take it. Otherwise, we can just directly jump into the session.
You can proceed, Amanda.
Yeah, thank you. Let me just make this bigger. Do you see the screen? Is it well and good?
Yes, we could see your title slide. Yes.
Great. So today I'm going to talk about the world of data, right? Specifically the buzzwords that you hear: artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, data science, and everything. I don't intend to give you all the details, which is already there on the internet. I just want to see if I can inspire you to get into this field where you could see your future, bright future as well, because artificial intelligence and machine learning is here to stay, at least for next 20, 30 years before we get into some other era. Right. So that's what I'm going to talk about. I'm sure you have seen all these things, right? You use Google on a day-to-day basis. You go type something and you see that there's a automated suggestion coming out as to what you could type further, or there's a suggestion as to what you are thinking, and it just suggests that this might be what you want to see next. So saving your time. So what is happening there is a machine learning model at the back end, or an AI model or a deep learning model at the back end, is trying to predict what you want to say next, right? So that is one thing. Oh, all I'm trying to tell you is these are the things which you already know and you've seen them. It is just that you're not aware these are the things which are built by machine learning or AI in the sense. So you see this screen here with respect to this map, right? So on the map, you'd see there are many cars. And let's say you book your car from some location and you want to go to somewhere else, or the cab for that matter, Ola, Uber, whatever you want to see. How would you know that what could be the nearest cab and how much time you're going to take to reach that particular location. These are the things which are driven by AI. Also, you might take a picture which is kind of dark or blurry in nature, and you want to enhance its capability and visual abilities, right? So it builds you a new image, new kind of image, which beautifies your image. And then you must have heard about Google lenses, right? You have the image to the right. Let's say this is the image. And you want to see, if you want to buy this particular hat, what you could do is, you could just upload this image to the Google lenses, and the Google lenses identifies that particular image or the hat, and then tells you what are the portals or the e-commerce websites or portals where you can find these products, what are their recommendations, what are those prices and everything. And you know that this is the world of autonomous cars being built now, completely automated cars. Not all of it is an AI. There are many other techniques like blockchain, IoT and other stuff, but most of it is AI. So what is happening when the car drives it soon, on its own automatically? So what is happening is it is trying to identify all those objects near you. Let's say that you are driving, you're sitting in an automated car. How does it decide? Let's say there are two cars in front of you and you want to take a left after a signal, which is after 50 meters away from you. So it has to judge that, okay, there are two cars in front of me. They are going at a speed of 30 kilometers and I'm at a speed of 50 kilometers. I need to reduce it by say 20, 30 kilometers by the time I reach my point where I need to take a left turn. So how does it decide, right? So all these things are driven by the world of artificial intelligence. I know these are complex systems, but they are built on the basis of artificial intelligence. So why are we here? Because the data is around us. The data is surrounded by us. Every time we do hundreds of times Googling of whatever topics we want to see, what are the content we want to see, then every time we get into the social media world, posting our content, looking at someone else's content, seeing recommendations of your friends, seeing feeds of your friends, seeing news that you're interested in, seeing recommendations of who could be your friend's friend, those kind of things. And then you have video streaming platforms like Netflix, Amazon Prime, where multiple contents, videos are uploaded, and then a recommendation based on your characteristics, taste, location, all the geographical parts, they would suggest you as to what you might want to see, what could be the genre which you're interested in, right? Very similarly, you have multiple data coming in with respect to your e-commerce transactions, or when you get into the shopping malls, right? There you have a lot of products or all the catalogs, all the transaction details sitting there. So everywhere that you go, you see the data, right? So even a child of 6 months would want to be happy. Even if it's crying, if you want to stop it, you just have to give a mobile to the child and he or she would be cool, right? So because the data is driving you so much that you have the data all around you, which you don't realize the magnitude of the data that you're producing. It could be your TikTok videos or it could be your Instagram, everything. You're surrounded by the data. So as I speak through with you for about, say, next 40 minutes, think about data, only data, right? So this is where the world of data science fascinates us. My intention from this webinar is that I help you understand those fundamentals of machine learning, AI, and data science. And then we will talk about learning and career path. Because I am here to inspire you, I should tell you how to learn this. And I should also tell you where you could see yourself someday if you at all choose data science or machine learning or AI as your career path, right? So let's begin. The first thing I would talk about is obviously machine learning, artificial intelligence, data science fundamentals, the basics that we need to understand. Before we get in anywhere, we should know the basics, right? I will try my level best to keep it to very simplistic approach. It should be very easy for you to understand. I just don't want you to sit for next 1 hour listening to something which you don't understand. So I'll try to relate to your life most often. So if there are any questions, please pop it to me. I can answer it to you, right? So let's go ahead. So there is this world, which is called as data science world, right? And then there is machine learning, then there is artificial intelligence. There are misconceptions as to how the world of data science is, how is machine learning different from artificial intelligence, which is different from machine learning or deep learning or data science itself, right? So it so happens that when you get into an industry and you're working for some firm, or it is your own firm and you're working on a data science solution, or you are a freelancer or whatever you do, there are some process or life cycle that you need to follow, and it is called as a data science life cycle. And the one who does this process is called as a data scientist. And there are many colleagues of a data scientist who sit around him and do many of the jobs. Okay, let's take a simple example. Now, let's assume that you are in a banking system. You are a financial analyst. You work for any big company like Citi or HDFC, HSBC, ICICI, whatever you could think of. And you are a financial analyst there, and you've been asked to build a system which analyzes or detects fraudulent transactions, right? When I say fraudulent transactions, you know that we are into the era of digital. So you have credit cards, internet login systems where you could do the transactions digitally. It could be your Google Pay or whatever it is. So when someone does the transaction, you just need to verify whether it is the same person who has that account is doing that particular transaction, or it is happening in a malpractice way, right? So all you need to do is look at the transaction and say whether this is a genuine transaction or someone has fraudulently got access to your system and he's trying that particular transaction so that he could get the money out of you, right? It is a stealing money kind of thing. So you build that. So that is what is your business understanding, right? So this is called as, this is called in many ways, it's called business understanding, it's called problem statement, it is called user case, something like that, use case, something like that. So whenever you are a data scientist and you work on something, first thing that you come across is this business understanding. You need to know what you're working on. So in my case, the problem statement is to solve that fraudulent transaction, right? Or just see which are fraudulent transactions so that I can tag it and the banking system will take care of everything else. So once you know what you're trying to achieve, the next thing that you want to do is data mining. As I said, the banking system might have many systems where your data is getting stored. It could be a SQL database. It could be a big data system like Hadoop or whatever it is. But you need to have a data on which you want to work on, right? You want to have that historical data of all those transactions which were actually known to be fraudulent or which are correct transactions. So when you do the data mining, you're fetching the data so that you can build your machine learning models on top of the data. So that is what is called as data mining. And then there is something called as data cleaning, right? So the data that you're extracting from your system need not be in a state where you can readily use it. So you need to manage your data, clean the data, and make it readily available for your model. That is the thing. Then you do something called as data exploration. Let us assume that the data that you extracted from your SQL server or wherever the data was residing into a simple Excel document, right? Let us assume that Excel document has 30 columns. One of the column is name of the customer. Second could be the time when the transaction was done. Third could be the amount. Fourth could be the device, fifth could be the IP address, and so on. Think of this as the Excel document where you have all the data, right? That is what is your data. Then you have data exploration to do. Then what you do is you take each and every column and see what are these features like, right? What could be the highest amount which was transacted? What could be the lowest amount which was transacted? What is an average amount which was transacted? How many times did this particular person transact during a particular day, particular month? Right? That is what is called as data exploration. Once you do that, if you have 30 columns in your data, you don't have to feed all the columns to your machine learning models to do the prediction. All you need to do is from your business understanding, from your multiple explorations, you could decide what columns to be fed. That is what is called as this feature engineering, right? Feature engineering in the sense you select what columns to feed. Also means that there could be some data which is not available in your system. You got the data from a SQL server, but there are some data. For example, that location might have some details. For example, the zip code of that particular location. If you want to pull that, you might not have that readily available in your banking system. Then you might want to go outside on the internet extract the data and put it back. So feature engineering also means that not only use the data that you have in your system, but also use the data which is outside your network, right? So that is what is feature engineering. Then this is the most interesting part, predictive modeling, okay? Predictive modeling in the sense, you are trying to build an algorithm or a model which will do the prediction whether a transaction is a genuine transaction or a fraudulent transaction, right? This is where your machine learning, artificial intelligence, or deep learning algorithms come into picture. So in the whole life cycle of a data science, machine learning, AI, deep learning, everything sits only here in predictive modeling, right? So when someone says he is a data scientist, that means he is managing the end-to-end life cycle. And when someone says he's a machine learning engineer, that means he's only working on this aspect of it, where he's building that machine learning model. So ultimately, once you build your models and other things, what you need to do is you need to see those things, right? When you want to convey to your CEO, COO, CMO, whoever it is, or all the directors, VPs, whatever solution you've built, and tell them how your solution is working, you want to story tell them, you want to give them insights of how your machine learning modeling is working, that is when you use data visualization, right? I'll quickly tell you a couple of things, right? Not all the things need to be done by one person. If it is done, then he is called as a data scientist. But all these things can be segregated into different roles, right? If you are only working on business understanding, then you are called as a business analyst because you are talking to the business person, understanding his pain points and trying to put it as a problem statement. That is why you are called as business analyst. Then you do this data mining, data cleaning, data exploration, feature engineering, all these things. If you can do from step 2 to 5, then you are called as a data analyst because you are taking the data, analyzing the data and putting into a format where it can be fed into the machine learning model. So you are a data analyst. And then you go to number 6, the 6th step, where you are doing some kind of modeling, where it could be a machine learning modeling, artificial intelligence modeling, or deep learning modeling, right? Or it, even if it is a simple statistical modeling, then you become that particular developer. You will become a machine learning developer, artificial intelligence developer, or a deep learning engineer, something like that. And then you have this data visualization. This is where you become a BI engineer because you work on visualization stuff. You are also called as a visualization engineer. You work on tools like Tableau, Spotfire, Power BI, all these big enterprise visualization tools. And one more thing which I missed is not all the data is readily available in hand to you. Then there is this between step 1 and 2, after step 1 and before step 2, there is something called as data engineer who works solely on those systems where the data is residing and tries to pull the data and give it to you. Okay, I will take a pause here. I hope I'm making sense to you. I've made it as simple as possible. Do you have any questions for me? Don't hesitate to ask questions, even if it is foolish or simple. That is fine. Okay, I will take that as a no. Okay, let's talk about the AI, machine learning, deep learning, the basics, right? So, you know, traditionally, there have been something called as software developers who work on building the software. So how are machine learning, AI, or deep learning is different from the software development, right? So most often, when you are a software developer, you know what you're building, right? So you know the logic. You would say, okay, if I add 2 + 2, it has to become 4. So let me write a program for that. Okay, if I want to download some content from a particular website, it has to hit that website, get the download, right? So what you know is, you know the logic, you know what you're working on, you try to get the data or get whatever task that you want to achieve, and you want to build that as a software, right? So that's where you become a software developer. But when it comes to machine learning development or a data science development, it is completely different. So like I was saying, when you are a software developer, you explicitly know what you want to do with your softwares, right? But when you are a machine learning engineer, you don't worry. Actually, you don't explicitly worry about what you want to do, but you know that from your problem statement, what you're trying to achieve. But what you do is you push the data to the algorithm, where algorithm tries to figure out what logic it needs to apply on its own, right? That is why you become a machine learning developer and you feed the data to the model, and the model figures out what you want to achieve, with respect to your data. That is the sole difference between a software developer versus a machine learning developer. Isn't it cool, right? You don't have to write a hell of a lot of code. Rather, you need to let your algorithms do the job, which can be written in 3-4 lines of code, right? That is one good thing about machine learning developer. Then there is data requirements. When it comes to software development, you don't have to have all the data, because we are in the data-driven world, and machine learning, AI, deep learning, everything deals with the data. We need to have high quality and high quantity of the data. That is one requirement of a machine learning development. Apart from that, when you build a software, if you have written a code for 2 + 2 = 4, and you want to generalize it to say 3 + 3 = 6, you have to go back and modify your code. But with respect to your machine learning has enough capability to generalize itself. It has the ability to predict on new unseen data points as well. I know there are more generic or more technical terms with respect to machine learning part. I'm just going to skip there. So this is what is the simple difference between a software development versus a machine learning development, right? So let's just define what are machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence, right? Machine learning is a simple task where you have the data and you want to train your machine learning model on that particular data, for which you feed the data to the machine learning algorithm, where an algorithm does its understanding on the data, does the pattern analysis on the data, and somehow it builds a logic on its mind and keeps it there and produces some results to you. So in a machine learning algorithm, you pass all those transactions and the model understands what are the genuine transactions, what are the fraudulent transactions, and ultimately tells you, hey, here, you are in India, you do the transactions often from Bangalore. It seems like someone sitting in Nigeria is managing your system. Can you just surely tell me if you are in Nigeria for now, right? Something like that. Because you see, you often do your transactions from Bangalore or anywhere else in India, but it seems like all of a sudden you are doing your transactions from Nigeria, right? That is what is machine learning system for you. So you feed the data, data understanding is done by the model itself, and then it allows you to tell you whether it's a fraudulent transaction or a generic transaction, right? So then you have deep learning. Deep learning is just an extended version of machine learning, where you have something called as neural networks, which I'm going to talk in about a few minutes from now. So it's just an advanced version. That's all you need to know. Then you have an AI. AI is, again, an advanced version of deep learning, where you want to imitate how a human being thinks, right? So like I was showing you that auto-driving car, not every part of it is AI. There are some other things as well, like blockchain, like IoT, many other technologies there. So when you want to achieve an AI, there are many systems which will come into picture apart from machine learning, deep learning as well. So these are the distinguishing patterns between what is an ML, DL, and AI, right? So when it comes to machine learning stuff, this is the general process, right? You have the data, whether it could be your emails, whether it could be your photos, whether it could be any structured data, you feed the data to the model, model analyzes and produces the results to you. You loop that through, you go back and see if you can improve your model. Then you make a decision at the end, which is your human. So this is your machine learning process, right? So this is what is machine learning all about. But when it comes to deep learning or AI, what makes a machine learning, deep learning on AI is that you have large data, right? Machine learning is capable of handling good amount of data on its own. But when it comes to managing large amount of data, specifically unstructured data, when I say unstructured data, it could be your speaking, it could be your text data, it could be your audio, it could be your YouTube videos or video data for that matter. That large data is what I'm talking about. Then you want a system where the compute is very high. You're not able to run your models only on your CPUs or your laptops, right? You want bigger computers, which are called GPUs. Then you come out with something called as neural networks. Neural networks are very similar to how our brain works. They are made up of something called as neurons. They try to connect your end-to-end systems, and then they will produce you the results, right? So that's why it's called neural networks. Hopefully what we try to do with deep learning or AI is that we completely try to imitate a human mind there as a model, right? That is what we want to achieve. So here's a simple example where you on the top, you have an untrained model, which is basically a neural network. Then what you do is your objective is that you want to feed the data in terms of images. You have a lot of images, whether it's a collection of hundreds of dogs or cats, whatever you see on Instagram, you just download it somewhere on your folder, and you want to push them through your machine learning, deep learning models, and the deep learning models try to understand those features from those images and then tells you whether this picture is a cat or a dog. So once you build this particular model, then you go deploy it and you could do a final prediction out of it. This is how Photos works. I'm sure all of you have those Android phone where you're backing up all your phones on Photos, right? Google Photos. Where if you have hundreds of photos, it still would be able to tell you that, hey, this is Manjunath, this is his friend, this is his mom, and so on, right? The same happens to you because there are very advanced models which are sitting, something called as transfer learning in machine learning, where you have all those images of yours and then you feed that to the model and that tells you whether it is a dog or a cat, whatever animal it is, or it is you, or it is your friend, and something so on, right? So someone had a question. Someone raised a question, raised a hand. Okay, if you have questions, please ask. Okay, hi, Vani madam. Okay, sorry. Yeah, someone had raised the hand.
Yeah, he has raised his hand.
Okay, would you want to ask question, Shakti? All right, then in the interest of time, I'll just continue. Yeah, we can ask the questions later. Yeah, sure. So why deep learning changes everything is you're not only dealing with your structured data, which is sitting in your Excel, you're also dealing with your data, which is in textual format, which is called NLP in particular. Then you have computer vision, all your face detection on your mobile, all your surveillance cameras on the street, right? There are systems even in China, just from your walking gestures, they could identify that it is you, right? That's how developed deep learning models are nowadays. So like I was saying, deep learning has that ability to manage those complexity with respect to the data, growing data itself. Second thing is it is faster, right? Faster with respect to the growing data itself. So if you look at that graph, right? There are three things, that deep learning sitting on top, then you have traditional machine learning, then you have human, right? There are limitations of what human could do, which can be surpassed with respect to machine learning models or deep learning. So what are the kind of real world problems that we solve is, I'm sure you know this in some or the other way, you just don't know that it is it, right? So you have this classification algorithm, like I was saying, if you have hundreds of pictures and you want to see whether this picture belongs to a cat, dog, horse, or a bear, you just want to see what it is, right? Then you feed that algorithm to something called as classification algorithm, because you're trying to classify what that object is. And if you know that there are four animals and I want to pick them, any one of them among them, right? That is when you go for classification. A regression is when you're trying to predict a numeric value, right? You want to predict what could be the sales. You want to predict what could be the salary that I want to pay to this particular person. You want to predict how many visitors will hit my website today. You are an Amazon. You want to know how many buyers will buy a particular product from my portal today, from which location, those kind of things. You have regression modeling. Then you have clustering. Clustering is grouping the content or the data that you have. It could be like, you don't know. You have all the features and you want to group the things. For example, you have hundreds of marks card in a, say, in your folder. It could be the marks card, digital marks card coming from computer science students, EC students, IS students, or whoever it is, right? All the things have been put into one particular bucket on a one folder on your computer, but you want to see them in different folders now. You want to have separate folder for computer science, separate for EC, separate for IS, and so on. So what you're trying to achieve is you want to group them based on the characteristics, inbuilt characteristics of the data. That is what is called as clustering, right? Association rule. Association rule basically means that I'm sure you've been to Big Bazaar, you've been to DMart. You know, there is something called as paddock patterns, right? Someone who buys a milk has a high probability of buying, say, a paneer, right? So someone who buy some grocery, he could also buy that grocery. So what is happening is, from association rules, in the sense you have millions of transactions, right? There could be thousands of people who go to DMart and buy something. What DMart does is they feed this data to the machine learning models and see what are the products which are brought together. Okay. So very similarly, Big Bazaar does this. You go to Big Bazaar, as and when you enter, you would see that all the related products are together, right? All the chocolates are together. Chocolates is very next to your cakes or your biscuits and so on, right? So what is happening there? We are trying to know the rules or association between the products so that we can arrange ourselves, and many people buy many things. I'm sure that gone are the days where we would go list our grocery list and say, okay, these are the products which I want to buy. But nowadays you would enter a shopping complex and you know that you don't want to buy anything, but you would still end up buying many things. Why? Because of association rules, right? Then you have structured output, then you have ranking, very similar to how your Google ranking works, right? You want to search something. There are thousands of documents on Google or thousands of portal, but how does Google suggest you the best portal for which the content you are looking out for? That is based on ranking, right? These are the kind of problems a machine learning engineer tries to solve. So it's very exciting. I just hope that it is not very boring to you. Not only this seminar, even if the career which you take, it would be very challenging. It would not be mundane. You won't feel bad. So like I was saying, there are three parts, right? You have an input where you are feeding your data. You have an output that is what you want to achieve, like in our case of transaction, whether it's a fraudulent transaction or a generic transaction. Then you have the model. These are the only three things which machine learning developer deals with, right? You have input, you have output, you have model. I know the complexity is different, but I'm saying these are, if you generalize something, these are the only three things that a data scientist does. I'm giving you some of the examples of what could be your output. If you can think of output, you could obviously think of your input, right? So that's why I'm talking about output first. It could be classifying document, very similar to how I was saying you want to segregate your marks card. That could be your thing. Predicting future cost of a resource, right? You want to hire a data scientist, you want to hire a data engineer, you want to see how much I could pay him in future, something like that. You can predict those numbers. Identifying the presence of something on an image, like I was showing that Google Lens picture where you could identify that this is a hat. On you can take any of the picture. For example, you took a picture on the beach, you could say, okay, these are balloons, these are people, these are whatever the object it is, right? Those kind of identification. Predicting the probability of an event, right? This could be very critical in terms of disaster management, right? If you want to predict when is an earthquake happening, when is something going wrong, it could be natural, those kind of things, you could do the predictions. Then summarizing a document. You have a document or you have a book of, say, 500 pages, you don't have time to read. What you could do is you feed this data to the machine learning model. The model summarizes the content to you and puts it to you in, let's say, 10 pages. So you can read the whole book in 10 pages. This is being done. If you go to your app store, right, Play Store and other things, you search for summarizing apps, they will summarize the whole content to you in about short pages, right? Recommending a product to your customer. This is not new to you. You've been on Flipkart, Amazon, everywhere. Yeah, that says a product brought by you was brought by someone else as well, but he also brought something else. Looks like you are also interested in it, or you could be interested in it. Okay, you brought this book A, B, C, you could also be interested in book B. Okay, you brought this t-shirt, this, you could also be interested in this pant, right? Those are the recommendations that I'm talking about. Generating a risk score for a cyber intrusion event. This is the same thing which we were talking earlier. You just say what probability is that this particular transaction is a fraudulent transactions. So today, if you have read the news, there was Twitter where all the popular people's accounts were hacked and there was a ransom request based on Bitcoins. So had they had sophisticated machine learning models which could have detected that there could be an intrusion to your system, they would not have had such solution. I'm sure Twitter has it, but someone has broken it. Identifying the spoken language in conversation. I could speak in Hindi, you could speak in English, someone could speak in Chinese, right? We could also identify. So these are the kind of things which you want to output, right, from the model. So what could be the input? Inputs could be your images, right? You want to take an image and say what could be the object inside this image? What are the persons inside this image, right? The transcribed digitized text of conversation. That means as and when I speak, you have this Zoom thing where if you go inside Zoom, there is something called as transcript. As and when I speak, it produces the text to you. That is machine learning for you. I hope I could show that later. I'll show you that later. So timestamp events from sensors. These are very critical in terms of industries. if you want to know what is failing next, you want to know what is happening to my big industrial systems, you want to do that. Historical sales records, that's what I was saying with respect to that association rules, right? Product brought by this particular customer, also brought this particular customer, so that it is easy for me to shelf them so that we can buy more and more and the company makes more money. Behavior of the online customers visiting a website. So basically, if you are Flipkart, you should know that on what location of this particular page, I have the highest chances of a person buying, right? That's how you see that buy now, order now, or located in somewhere. They are designed that way. It's not a coincidence that they are placed there, right? There is a scientific research that goes on as to where should I place my content, where should I put my logo, how should I project the product, how should I put the images, everything goes on there. Demographic information about a person. I'm sure that there could be 50 people on the call. We can just in next 10 minutes say who's what is he doing, where is he located. This is all because you are connected to Google and Google is tracking you, right? So these are my data and inputs. So ultimately, when we say what are machine learning models, right? You don't have to think this as an out of box system. Let's say that I'm going to simply take two things, right? X could be your age. Think of this as age. Don't worry about these numbers. This is just representative. X could be your age and you want to say what could be your salary, Y, right? You have only two variables. X is called as an independent variable. Y is called as your target variable. That is what you want to predict. What could be your salary based on your age? So for a machine learning model, all you need to do is feed your independent variable, which is X, and tell the model what could be your dependent variable, Y, and give all the historical data. Okay, this person is 25 years of age, he earns 3 lakhs. This person is 48 years in age, he earns 25 lakhs, and so on. You feed this data, and the model tries to understand what could be this X, what could be this Y, and tries to plot them internally. You can't see that, but they do something like that, and then finally they produce an equation, right, where Y equal to MX plus B. Y is your target variable. So you built a model which said, if you can tell me age, I will tell you what could be your salary, right? This is your simplest model. So it says that your salary could be 0.1 times your age plus 0.45. And this is the model. So in simple terms, a model is a mathematical equation formed by the machine learning model itself. In some of the models, you would know what is this equation. In some of the models, you cannot know it because it is so complex that you cannot see how those equations are driven, right? So this was all about machine learning and AI. I will take a pause here. Maybe we will keep the questions to the last. Okay, let me just go ahead and tell you about the career path and the learning that is required, right? So what is your data science career path, right? So just a minute. Yeah. So when you become a data scientist, right? You work in a team, although you are most of the time individual contributor, you work in a team where you as a data scientist sit with a architect, right? Application architect, that's what is AA is called. DS is data science, AA is application architect. Then you understand your business objective. This is very similar to I was saying how you understand your business problems, right? You see that there's a VP, CEO, whoever comes to you and tells you that, okay, this is my problem. How can you solve it with data science, right? This is this particular part. Then you have data science, data engineer, architect. You all sit there and say, okay, where do I have this data and how do I procure it for my machine learning development or data science development? That is formed by this particular team. Then you have a data scientist and data analyst. Once you have the data, like I was saying, you have many processes there, data mining, data cleaning, data exploration, data feature engineering, right? These things are done by data scientists and data analysts. Then you have a data scientist who can also be called as a machine learning AI engineer at this point in time, who trains your model. And then ultimately, there are something called as ML ops, right? ML operations team, where you have DevOps who will take your model and deploy that model to you. It could be an application architect or it could be a DevOps engineer. So ultimately, once you build that model, you might want to update model periodically because of the changing distribution in the data, then you become a data scientist. So these are the various roles that you have when you enter the world of data science, right? So I know that you are freshers and it is very important that I talk to you about your thing. Where can you enter, right? So you could be a business intelligence developer. When I say that, I mean you are someone who's interested in storytelling things. You are someone who believes in visualizing stuff, putting those jazzy things on the screen, where a high level person who's sitting as a VP or director, he cannot get into the data and understand each and every point. Rather, you as a data visualization engineer or a BI engineer, beautify those images and say that these are the sales, these are the resources, these are the profits that you have made, these are the losses you have made, those kind of things. That then you become a BI engineer. Believe me, these are the entry level designations which are available. That's what I'm talking about. So if at all you are interested, you could land up being one off on this job, right? So this is BI engineer. Then you have data engineer. Like I was saying, you don't have to have the data readily available. It could be sitting in hundreds of systems. It could be a SQL, it could be a Hadoop, it could be Hive, it could be Spark, it could be many things or many locations where the data resides. So the data engineer's job is to pull the data and give it to you, right? So you could be a data engineer if at all you're interested in working on system side of things, getting the data, doing large level data extraction kind of stuff. Then you could become a data analyst, right? So a data analyst is one, once you have the data, you explore everything. We have listed all the things with respect to that, right? And he's also an assistant to a data science scientist. And then you have a data scientist who's an expert in managing end-to-end stuff, who builds the machine learning models, who does the model retraining, everything, who looks at the things end-to-end and builds those products which is required. So you could land up being any one of these guys if you get into this entry-level data science professionalism. So when it comes to skill matrix, okay, don't worry about those ratings and other things. Don't worry about the left-hand side as well. I know it looks very similar to our VTU syllabus, which is very big, but don't worry. You grow with your time, right? You don't grow in a day. You learn things over a period of time. So obviously you should know a bit of statistics. You don't have to be a statistics master, right? You just have to know a bit of statistics for data science. Then obviously there are programming languages which you are already learning. Python is predominantly used. I use in my day-to-day system Python to build those enterprise level solutions. R, I seldom use it in my day-to-day life. It's a statistical programming language which is catching up with Python, but not to the greater extent, because productionizing those models built using R statistical programming is not great, okay? Then you have Hadoop, basically a data system where the data is stored. Don't worry about it. Not many data scientists deal with Hadoop. Tableau or Power BI or Spotfire or Qlik, all these things are visualization tools. If at all you want to become a BI engineer, you could become that. Data cleaning, data wrangling, machine learning, algorithms, these are the core of machine learning or data science engineer, right? So you should learn those things. Business acumen is obviously, you should know how to talk, you should know how to understand the problem statement. Because not every problem statement is same, not every application that you work on is same. So you should have good enough understanding to the real world, and you could relate your data science stuff to the problem statement that is being spoken from your higher authority, right? That is what is business acumen. Cloud computing, yes, we are moving towards cloud-based solution, whether it's AWS, Amazon, Databricks, many other things are there which you could work on. Database management, very similar to the Hadoop, which we were talking about. It could be your SQL servers, it could be MySQL, it could be NoSQL, it could be your data warehouses where you are storing your unstructured data, like your Facebook, right? Where do you store your images? Where do you store your text contents? Every time we go update some status, every time we put a story, that has to be stored somewhere, right? They are database management system. Data modeling relates to the same thing. It basically tells you what is the kind of schema on which where we need to store the data. Right, familiarity with GPUs. If at all you are working on large data sources, then you should know the GPUs. Right, these are the skill matrix which is required for you. Where do you see yourself in years to come? This is a copy paste from some other portal, so please see this. You start as a junior engineer, right? Junior data scientist, where your experience is 0 to 2 years. They say average salary is 7 lakh. Then you have you want to learn Python, pandas, those kind of things when you start as a junior developer or junior data scientist. Then you become a progression. After 2 years, you become an associate data scientist or a senior analyst, those kind of things. Then you become a senior data scientist, which is about, say, 4 to 8 years of age. You are rich in experience now. You know the things better. Then you become a product manager or a product owner, where you are managing the end-to-end product. Then you become a lead data scientist where you are managing enterprise level kind of solutions. Then you become a director, VP, SVP, where your salary could be 50 lakh plus and so on. I'm not exaggerating these numbers because I know those are the real numbers. So I'm not only motivating you from your working perspective. I know money is important. So if you want to take it, go ahead and take it. So where to start, right? This is the last slide before I jump in. I want to spend some time here. I know we are already ending the time. But it's important that I tell you how to learn things, right? So if you want to become a data scientist, at least for next 5 to 10 years, one language that you should know or predominantly learn is Python, right? Learn Python basics. Then you should learn a bit of algebra, statistics, and a machine learning, basic machine learning kind of stuff. Then you have some predominant packages, which are called as Pandas, NumPy, Matplotlib, Scikit-learn, Bokeh. So Pandas is for all the data pre-processing, data munging, data wrangling, pulling the data, exploring the data. That is what I was speaking about. That's what you do in Pandas. NumPy is for faster management of your data because you have huge data. NumPy is a package which works close to the mathematical relationship within the data. Matplotlib is used for visualizing the things. Like I was saying, if you have 30 columns in your Excel, you want to see what is happening with each your data, each your column, right? You want to plot a distribution of age, right? Okay, the banking system has persons starting at the age of 20 and that ends at, let's say, some 90 years. And the person of age 20 years has on an average money of, say, 50,000 rupees and so on, right? You want to see the distribution. That is why you use Matplotlib. There are many other packages known as Plotlib, but you start here, Matplotlib. Then you have Scikit-learn, which is the core machine learning package. Like I was saying, you don't have to code everything. There could be custom solutions where you need to code, but Scikit-learn is a package where you have all the machine learning algorithms listed. You just call those algorithms, send in your data, it does the analysis and produces to you. I know I'm sounding very easy, but it is not as easy, but it is not as difficult as well. Bokeh is similarly a visualization package, right? You use these packages and learn how to do the exploration and visualization on your data. That is your step four. Then you should learn to deal with data pre-processing. In the sense, all the data which is available to you might not be in a format which is ready to be pushed into a machine learning model. You should know how to play around the data and clean the data. That is what is your data pre-processing. Then you have feature selection and engineering. Like I was saying, from your business acumen, from your data itself, you should know if there are hundreds of features, hundreds of columns in your data, and you want to push everything into your model, it is not a worthy solution. So you should know what to select and what to ignore from your business acumen. That is what is your feature engineering. Then you have basic and advanced machine learning algorithms. I know you had learned statistics. Now you should learn all the algorithms. It could be linear regression, logistic regression. I'm sure that you have artificial neural network as a part of your subject as well in VTU syllabus. Then you have support vector machines. You have decision trees, random forest, ensemble modeling. There are many, many different modeling techniques. That is what forms basic and advanced machine learning. Then you have deep learning models where you start with simple feed-forward network, neural network. Then you can go to a recurrent neural network, LSTMs, transfer learning. Then you have CNN algorithms, which is basically to deal with your image data and so kind of things. Then what you do is once you learn all these things, you go on GitHub, put your content, what are the things that you worked on, put it on the GitHub, then start participating in competitions, right? There is something called as Kaggle. Remember this word. Kaggle is a portal where you have many data science competition going on. Even if that data science competition expires, the data will be there, the codes will be there. See, the best way to learn is learn from someone else, right? Not start learning on your own from scratch. Someone has already done it. Go look at it. How did they do it? What did they do it? Why are they doing these things? And then compare it with 10 other people. Then you get to know the 10 different approaches of doing that machine learning model, right? That is how you do. When you participate, you increase your confidence. That is what I want to say. Then you want to build your portfolio, right? As your student, no company expects you to know everything. So remember one thing, even when I was passing out of college, I had this expectation that everybody wants you to know everything. It is fine if you don't know everything. It is fine if you know 50% of it. But you should know this 50% far better than many of other people, right? So when you work on something, you just stick to it. Okay, so one advice I have is when you go to interviews, it is better to tell them beforehand what you know. That is why you have that question, tell me about yourself. So put it very clearly that these are the things which I know, and you could ask. So you are indirectly giving that person an impression that, okay, these are the things which are very good, which I know very good. You could ask any questions out of them, right? So that is where you build your portfolio. I would suggest that post you do this step 1 to 9, build 4 or 5 projects, right? You go to internet and search for machine learning model building projects. You find hundreds of them. Pick any 5 of them from different genres, whether it's a classification, clustering, regression, anything, right? Then build your portfolio, build your products. Then you are done, right? You put it there on your GitHub. You put it on your resume. Now start applying for your jobs. I know this is a pandemic scenario, but trust me, there are more than 1.5 lakh jobs open in India at the moment for data scientist roles, right? Go ahead and apply. So if you want some references of whatever I've spoken, the learning stuff, all the content which is required, all the tutorials that you want to see, major ones that I've put up here on this particular link, I would obviously share this presentation with Bhuvaneshwari madam. She could circulate this. And if at all you want to connect with me, you could click on this LinkedIn button. You can connect to my LinkedIn, then we can communicate there. I will take a pause here. I know I've had a long 1 hour. I've spoken all the time. I will let you speak now. Yeah, please. Someone was raising the hand. Go ahead. Madam, we can take the questions now.
Yeah, yes. Who's raised? Any questions you can type?
That's fine. If you can unmute yourself and talk. Yeah.
But unmute whether they can.
It will be better if they can type the questions so that the clashes will not be there.
Sure,
so if
sure,
they can
sure.
type the questions, we can pick up one by one and answer. We will not miss out any. So
anyone is having any questions, please type it.
Don't worry, I have another 15-20 minutes for you. I will try my best to answer your questions. Even if they are half questions, even if you don't know something, that is fine. Please ask them. Don't be afraid to fail, okay? When you are in college life, that is the phase when you should fail. They say fail early and fail well so that you pass or you succeed once you are out of the college. So this is the time to ask questions, right? And trust me, guys, this is one of the finest job profiles that you are going to build in your career, right? Okay, I have 3 chats. Programming starting point will be Python. What about databases? You don't have to know everything about databases, right? There is a data engineer. If you want to become a data engineer, obviously you want to know the databases, but that's fine. You just need to know what is a SQL, how to extract the query, right? How to extract your data. Certificate will, link will be sent to you. Okay, that's madam's. Vani madam, hi Vani madam. Thanks a lot. Anyone else has any other question? Can you please explain me difference between AI ML deep learning with one more example? Okay. See, it could be like you have a problem statement. Obviously, all of the solutions could be solved using all the things, right? Machine learning is simply an advanced perspective of a statistics. Like I was saying, that banking system. I will not take the banking system example because I already told you about that. Let's take the example of a recommendation system, right? You go to Flipkart, then on the down, you see that, okay, person who brought this also brought this thing. Then if you are doing it on only text data, right, you could do that on your machine learning algorithm. Okay, that is what is machine learning for you. And when it comes to images, right, you want to show the images as well and compare things and do things, then you have the data in larger context. That's where you could use your deep learning algorithm. Okay. Artificial intelligence is a blurry word, which is very similar to deep learning, right? Artificial intelligence is a combination of many other things. But if it could be a standalone thing, it could be a standalone as well. So machine learning, you could use on your text data. For example, you go to Google Translates, right? Where you just want to convert one language to other language, those kind of things you could use machine learning. And if at all your data is very small, you could use that. Then you have deep learning where you have huge amount of data. You want to build your own product. For example, you want to build chatbots, right? You go to ICICI, you go to Swiggy, you want to build chatbots, you would say, okay, I ordered this particular product, I ordered this particular food, it's been 40 minutes, I did not get it. Those kind of questions that you ask, you're actually asking these to a machine learning system or a deep learning system. It's very blurry. If you have large amount of data, you would say you would go with deep learning. Or if you have unstructured data, you would prefer deep learning. If at all you have the data in an Excel format, you go prefer machine learning, right? Is it compulsory to do master's in data science to become a data scientist? I don't think so. I haven't done master's. I do have certification, but I feel it is not that important. In fact, even though I paid huge money for that certification, I never used it. Even today, when I want to apply for new jobs or I want to say something about me, I don't even prefer to mention the certification. You don't need to have a certification. If you know what you are doing and you are good at doing it, then you don't need certification. How about data stream management? Do they need to know about that? Because as far as I've seen, our IBM data visualization comes with streams. If new guys are coming, which tool will be best to start for stream? Stream is real-time data, right? Not all the companies which you get into will work on the real-time data, right? What you're talking about is it could be your Facebook feeds, it could be your Twitter feeds, it could be your Pinterest feeds, it could be your Instagram, it could be your real-time transactions which is happening on Flipkart, those kind of things. But you, as an entry point, you don't get into it. I don't think you, as an entry point engineer, will get into data streams kind of thing. You have a long way to go, don't worry about it. Sir, can we get access to real-time machine learning models and from where we can get those models? There are hundreds of models sitting on GitHub. You just go search for models or machine learning models. Or if you have time, go to LinkedIn, ping me. Whenever I have time, I would lead you to the link where you could get the models. There is nothing called as real-time machine learning models. There are codes written on machine learning. There is a data setting. You need to experiment. Or if at all you want to say that there are real-time models, you have one example here. Give me a minute. I was talking about lenses, right? Google lenses. This is where you have real-time machine learning models. The thing is you don't get to see. So you have the picture from your image, which you've captured, then you could just say scan it, right? This is the real-time machine learning stuff happening for you, right? You have some product, you want to buy it, you could do that. That is your real-time stuff for you. And I promise that I would show this thing to you. Control, where do we have this? Copy streaming. I had this, unfortunately, I don't see that. Okay, what happens is when you go to this particular tool, right? Zoom, and you are speaking, that produces your spoken words instantly and shows you on the screen. Okay. Sir, can you mention some platforms to learn data science? Okay, there are so many platforms, right? You have Jigsaw Academy, you have InsoFay from where I have the certification. You have many online portals like Coursera, you have Udemy, you have many other things. You want to pay, you will pay. If you don't want to pay, there are many other courses. Fortunately, what I've done is all the free things, right? You want to learn, I have put those contents here. If you just go, they will tell you step by step how to become a data scientist. What are the things that you need to read? What are the things you need to do? You have everything there. Don't worry. It's there. Any other questions? How do we select TensorFlow Keras for application in deep learning? TensorFlow is an engine which was built by Google, which is used for deep learning kind of work, right? Keras is a wrapper around it. So if you are choosing TensorFlow or a Keras, it doesn't matter to you. When I say wrapper around it, see TensorFlow, if you want to build a model, you need to write hundreds of lines of code. But in Keras, the same could be written in 10 lines of code because the same thing has been transcribed to something else. That's where you use Keras. So on the backend, you could have your TensorFlow or Python or something like that. On top, you could have your Keras where you're working on the deep learning application. I hope I answered your question. How important is AWS for data science? It depends on the company which you're working on. Not all the companies use AWS. if at all you are using AWS, then you don't have to put your head on learning Python so much, right? Because AWS has something called as AWS SageMaker, where you have all the machine learning models already built. You just pull the data, pass it to the model, produce the result, productionize it. That's all you do. It's a kind of drag and drop kind of work. I would say if you want to start your career, don't start there. If at all you're getting it, that's well and good. You have Google Cloud, you have Azure Machine Learning Studio, you have AWS SageMaker. There are many things. But start with programming. It gives you a real feel of how to build a data science. Yeah, if at all you want to start with AWS, go ahead, do it. How are you connecting AI and ML? Madam, could you please elaborate more? Are you saying once I build a model, how do you productionize it? Is that the question for me?
Madam.
Okay. See, I work in an enterprise system where I build solutions, not only just machine learning solutions, right? I mean, I might have to take an hour to tell you this, but if you want me in brief, there are many tools available in real world, which helps me build those data pipelines, then take it to the server where it could be a cloud-based solution where I could host my machine learning models, which I've trained, and then connect my data stream to that machine learning models. And then finally, I produce the results out of it and put it on an UI. UI, obviously, I don't build it. When I say UI, it could be a website on which you are displaying your results of your machine learning model. Some other team does it. But I build those machine learning models. I productionize it. There are many, many tools. If you want, I could just share the screen. Someone, if you are interested, please go ahead. And if you are done with machine learning, right, you could go ahead with full stack deep learning. This course tells you about everything, how to set up your machine learning modeling, how to productionize it, how to connect with your data, how to tackle your machine learning team itself, what are the challenges that you come across when you train, how do you deploy your model, how does it work, research, everything, whether you are talking about Keras, FastAI, TensorFlow, PyTorch, whatever it is. Okay, I will just leave a ping here. I have not added this to my chat. Can you specify few more like SVM in? Okay, SVM is called a support vector machine. I'm not going to get into details of it. There is something called as random forest. You should learn it. Okay, let me take it from basic, right? If you are starting with an algorithm, learn from linear regression, then start with logistic regression. Then you have decision trees. Then you can go towards support vector machines, where you have linear support vector machines and kernel-based support vector machines. Then you have random forest, then you have XGBoost, then you have CatBoost, then you have GBMs. Then you can go towards deep learning models like neural network, feed-forward neural network, autoencoders, CNN, RNN, LSTMs, BERT models, and so on. Right? I hope I have answered your question. Anyone else has any question for me? How to start with BI tools? Please mention some open source tools. Okay, if you want to learn about open source tools, I'll leave a message here. It's called Plotly, then you have Bokeh, then you have Matplotlib, then you have Seaborn. Please go Google it, you will get everything on this part. But when you say BI tools, I don't think any enterprise companies will use these open source tools unless you are a Python developer and you are developing from scratch. If you want to learn BI tools, then you should learn Spotfire. Pick any one of them. That should be great. Power BI. Power BI has great source. It is from Microsoft. Do use it. Then you have Tableau. Then you have Click. Right? Go ahead, explore these. Do Power BI provide free trial? Yes, they do provide a month's worth of free trial. You should use it. You have many things like web-based Power BI. You could desktop your Power BI with a .exe file, or you could have server-based Power BI. Any other questions? I know whatever I spoke to you is very high level. I just wanted to build some interest in you, and I'm not the first person talking to you on machine learning and AI, that for sure I know that. And you must have already explored on your own. You could be an expert in something else, which I don't know. So if at all there are some things which you want me to explain in details, obviously I could take one more session and come back to you. But talk to me only about data science, right? I'm not an expert in BI tools. I can talk to you about many data science stuff. You can talk to me about anything from data extraction to productionizing a model. You could talk to me about end-to-end process as to how it goes, how do we do in our official work, those kind of stuff.
Okay. Hope we have done the session. Anybody is having any questions? Okay. Thank you, Manjunath. Wonderful session. And you have explained in and out of data science, okay, AI and ML, deep learning also. So now I think I invite Deepika madam to give the vote of thanks. And after that, if our staff, if you want to talk to our Manjunath, you can unmute and talk. I think Sripati sir is there. And Chavan sir already spoke, I think, Vani madam. And you can, after the vote of thanks, we can have this session. Okay.
A very good morning, one and all. So today's session, I'm going to propose the vote of thanks. So it gives me immense pleasure to propose the vote of thanks. So first, I would like to thank our principal for his encouragement to conduct such a events. And I would like to thank our beloved HOD, Dr. Rangia sir, for his moral support and guidance. And I would like to thank our coordinator, Bhuneshwari ma'am, for making all the webinar events as a grand success by extracting the work from our alumnus and making it a best one. And I have to thank our today's speaker, Mr. Manjunath, for his thought-provoking session. So in his busy schedule, he itself come forward to help our students. So that's a beautiful thing what he has done to our college. So it gives us a proud moment to feel and share the feeling of our students. So he already spoke many things about what he has done during his college time also. And he never forgot about his lecturers and professors also. So that's such a good thing. So what we can see from him, and this surely inspire our students also. So finally, I have to thank our students who have turned up to make this webinar a good one. So I thank all our staff members and faculty team for their cordial cooperation. So thank you all.
Thank you, Deepika madam. And now we are winding up the session. And staff, you want to...
Hi, ma'am. Morning here.
Hi. Morning. Yeah.
Manjunath, hi.
Hello, madam. How are you?
I am fine, Pa. I am very proud of you. You are doing very good. Today's session is very nice, very in-depth. If I have delivered your session, is very good.
Yeah,
it's very silent in the class, actually. I was remembering you that 2011, what actually in 7th semester real-time operating system I was teaching you.
Yeah,
you were very silent in the class. I don't in the sense of what actually I wanted to tell you in the sense. So you're a very prestigious company. You are doing this job, that to Dell company.
Yep.
That to in the sense upcoming AI and ML is very upcoming market. So you have a very good knowledge, and all the best for your future endeavors.
Thanks a lot, madam. Thanks a lot. Okay, I was talking about the same stuff. real-time system. Maybe you joined late. I was talking the same thing to you.
Okay. Yeah. I joined late, little bit. 5 minutes late, I have joined actually.
Yeah.
Okay, Manjunath. Very nice. Very nice.
Manjunath, actually, yeah. I send an invitation to Kumar sir also.
Okay.
So today he sent a message and he asked me to convey you. Manjunath project batch, they were very good and I cherish always in God. May God bless them. He asked me to convey a message to you. As he is busy in his PhD thesis submission, he couldn't join today.
Oh, no worries.
Okay, he thanks asked a lot. To convey this. Okay.
He was my project guide as well. Yeah. So we did present a couple of things internationally.
Yes. So sir asked me to convey the message.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, Vijay ma'am, today Shri ma'am didn't join, I think. Sir, Shripati sir is there. I saw Shripati sir. Sir, lift up. No, I saw.
Shripati sir is not there, ma'am.
Not there. I saw.
Janavi
Vishnumurthy.
Sir is there.
Sir can unmute, no? Or we have to do now. Okay. Sir? Actually, our HOD, sir. He wanted to conclude, but as he is having some meeting by 12:15, he left.
Okay.
So he asked me to convey his wishes and thanks also.
Oh, that's not a problem.
Actually, Shripati sir, he is there, but...
Hello?
Sir.
Madam.
Yes, sir.
My wife is muted.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hello, sir.
I'm there. Okay. Fine, appa chana idini. Okay. Today's program is very nice. In depth within a short period. You explained very clear and neat. Chanagide, all the best.
Thank you, sir. Nimag nodde ond sari na Rajeshwar Nagaradalle.
Iradille Rajeshwar Nagaradalle.
Okay, Vani madam ond sari nodiddene.
Near to the Bemmel complex.
ಓಹ್ ಹೌದಾ, ನಾನು ಬೆಮೆ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಸ್ ಹತ್ರ ನೋಡಿದ್ದು. ಆಮೇಲೆ ಸಂತೋಷ್ ಸರ್ಗೆ ಡ್ರೈವಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಸೆನ್ಸ್ ತಗೊಳಕ್ ಹೋದಾಗ ನೋಡಿದ್ದೆ.
ರೈಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ನೋಡಿರ್ತೀಯಾ? ಇಲ್ಲೇ
ಸುಮಿತಾ ಮನೋಜ್ ಮೇಡಮ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ದೇರ್ ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್.
ಯಾ, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸರ್.
ಮನೋಜ್ ಮೇಡಮ್,
ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ, ಬಾಯ್, ಆಲ್ ದಿ ಬೆಸ್ಟ್.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸರ್.
ಸುಮಿತಾ ಮೇಡಮ್, ಶಿ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್?
ಶಿ ವಾಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್.
ಮೇಡಮ್ ವಾಸ್ ದೇರ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್. And I think all our other staffs are there. Pushpa madam, Harita madam, Jyoti madam, and Ojashwini madam, Ajay sir, Santosh ji sir, and all our faculties are there. I think you may not be knowing, Sunita ma'am. Maybe you left by 2012. Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe all our staffs have joined today. I thank you all. And thank Manjunath also. And I thank our CTDS team, Kavita ma'am and Daphne ma'am, and joining with us and making these arrangements. And thank you all.
Thanks everyone, it was my pleasure being here. I thank you all for providing that opportunity. If at all there is something which is advanced and you want me to explain to students,